Hello, everybody, and welcome to Question and Answer Time. I'm your host, Adam Neely. I'm here answering all of your questions about bass and music in general. So let's get started. Rodrigo de Piérola writes, nice vlog. The Cajón guy, at least to my Peruvian ears, is not doing a good job. He's just going by the simplest possible way to play it by simply mimicking bass and snare.
So yeah, over the past, I'm going to say 5 to 10 years, there have been a lot of drummers who have adopted the cajon, the Latin American percussion instrument, as kind of this approximation of the sound of a full drum set for situations where a full drum set just wouldn't be practical or appropriate. There's a situation where a lot of singer-songwriters and a lot of artists might want to have what we would call acoustic sessions, whether or not it's actually acoustic or amplified acoustic instruments, but it's just the sort of like sound of a stripped down band, where they still might want to have the interaction between a percussion instrument and a rhythm section instrument and a melody instrument and a chord instrument. They want to have the same sort of dynamic as a full band, just in a more small contained setting. And a full drum set might be too loud for that. It also might take up more space, too much space on stage, and a cajon is great because it's nice and compact. You know, a full drum set also might be kind of a pain in the ass to carry around and transport versus a cajon, which is literally just a box you take and you move around. In New York City on the subway, you know, I know one drummer who likes playing the cajon gigs because, hey, on the subway, he always has a seat because, you know, sometimes the seats are taken up and, hey, you can just sit on the box and there we go, there's a seat. Traditionally, it's played in like cumbia and other styles of like South American music where it's just a very different feel, very different application. You're playing a lot busier than Josh was playing on that little cruda gig, Josh the cajon / drum set player. When you're playing in the situation where you have this hip hop, R&B, rock pop orchestra behind you, you have to adopt the same sorts of playing styles as you would for a drum set because that's the style that you're playing in. And speaking as a bass player, when a cajon player like Josh plays the way that he does, it's very easy to lock in with him because it's just taking all the same sorts of patterns and feels and grooves and just applying it to a very slightly different sort of sound set. The cajon is great at adopting the sound of a low kick drum and a high snare drum, and that interaction between low and high sounds is kind of integral to the percussive style of hip-hop, rock, R&B, all that sort of good modern sort of groove sensibility. You know, when you're looking at Josh play the cajon and it not feeling right and feeling too simple because he's not doing it the way that a normal cajon player in Latin American styles would be doing it, it's kind of similar to how a classical nylon string guitar player who is classically trained and knows all of the nuance of guitar technique and like knows his Villa Lobos and all that good stuff might look at an acoustic singer-songwriter guitar player who's strumming a guitar and playing some basic chords and accompanying themselves while they play. That classical nylon string trained guitar player might look at the singer-songwriter as being less of a guitar player because they are not adopting a full and rich history of the guitar into their guitar playing, and it's too simple and it's not as expressive. And while that's kind of true, it's also kind of missing the point because the aesthetic is wildly different and the point of the guitar playing is very, very different. It's kind of apples and oranges. And yes, it is kind of like an adoption and appropriation of the cajon to kind of like transfer it into the situation which it was not made to be part of, but that's kind of what's going on here. And it's kind of a more recent trend, kind of a more modern trend. Some drummers like it, some drummers dislike it. Fact of the matter is you can't think about it as a drummer playing a Latin American percussion. It's a drummer playing cajon in a very different context.
Reagan McCann writes, hey Adam, I'm a recent subscriber and I'm really enjoying all of your content so far. In a previous video, you mentioned you have to often turn down gigs because you already have something booked. Have you ever been in a situation where you got called for a gig that paid more / was a better opportunity than the one that you already committed to? How would you go about handling this?
Yeah, that's a question that a lot of musicians have to deal with quite frequently, and not just musicians, but freelancers in general, just trying to figure out what gigs to take and whether or not it's okay to back out of a gig for a gig that pays a lot more, because there's a lot of cost-benefit analysis that you have to do on this sort of decision. Like, if I back out of this gig, will I burn any bridges, and will I not get any more work from these people? Will I take this gig? If I take the higher-paying gig, will it lead to more higher-paying gigs, or is it just a one-off? Is it worth the sort of friction that I caused by taking the higher-paying gig? Now, the most professional thing to do is to not back out at the last second. Just try not to do that. Make sure that you get a substitute. In the United States, we call them subs. I think in the UK, call them deps, which I think means deputy. Make sure that your sub slash dep has a really strong understanding of the material that they're going to be subbing on. Give them charts, give them recordings. If you have a good sub for that gig and the band leader sees that you gave a good sub and was able to just completely hang, completely throw down, there are going to be no bridges burned and the band leader is going to be satisfied. If, and here's the big thing, if the band leader is equally as professional as you, because unfortunately in a thing like music, there are some very emotional band leaders and emotional people that get really, really disturbed by this idea of subbing something out. Now, granted, there are certain gigs that are very difficult to sub out for a variety of reasons. Maybe the material is very specific. Maybe it's like a band situation where you've played with them for like many years and they just doesn't have the same sort of chemistry with a sub. But a lot of times there's this emotional attachment to you playing a particular gig. And when you take a gig for more money, it can feel for a band leader like just this kick in the nuts. Like, oh my God, I can't believe this person sold me out. What happened to doing things for the music, man? You're just in it for the money. Are you willing to have that sort of weird friction with somebody? Maybe, maybe not. There's a lot of stuff that goes into this beyond just the money, and you should really be thinking about all of it. Take the situation which is best for you, because ultimately you are a business unto yourself and you should do what's best for your business.
Olivia Andersson writes, "Hey Adam, question for your next Q&A. I'm going to a music school after this summer. Here's the thing, I'm a transgender girl and that may be a problem for me because I'm gonna stand out and people may not wanna talk to me. You said many times that knowing somebody is everything in the music business. Then again, standing out makes it more likely that people will remember me after music school. What is your advice on the matter? Is standing out a good or a bad thing in the music industry?"
So my advice to you is to find a really strong group of people who will act as fellow musicians, bandmates, friends, and a support system for you. And this just is going to apply across the board, whether or not you're trans or any kind of musician. It's really important to have that. It would behoove you to adopt a close-knit circle of people to play your music and to just be friends with you. But it's going to especially be the case for you because, unfortunately, I'm going to tell the truth here. I really don't know of anybody who is a trans musician. I mean, maybe it's just the group of people that I've been hanging out with or just the circle that I find myself in, but it's just not a very common identity among musicians. That identity of a trailblazer, of being a open trans musician, that is just going to be another layer of just, I guess, burden on you. And having a good support system is going to be that much more important. Now, that said, musicians in general are a fairly open bunch, and there isn't a lot of like transphobia or homophobia or anything, at least within the musical community. But just because there isn't that doesn't mean that it's common to have trans musicians. It's possible. It's not going to be crap. Music is amazing. It's a really amazing thing, and you should really become a musician because I think it's really a transcendental experience, but you will have to deal with additional things that unfortunately not everybody else has to deal with.
Fergus writes, "Hi Adam, seeing this talent raises a question in my mind. Do you think musicians have a harder time, quote, making it in the music industry in cities like New York where the standard of musicianship is so high?"
So I'm gonna kind of like paraphrase something that Maria Schneider said. And if you don't know who Maria Schneider is, she's a really amazing Grammy Award winning jazz big band composer. So definitely check her music out if you haven't already. But she basically was trying to figure out why the music scene in a place like New York was just really amazing and other places were pretty good, but just not to the level as it was in New York. And, you know, in Europe and other places, you have government support for the arts. In the United States, there's almost none of that. There's no grants. There's just no public money going to arts or artists. So why is the musicianship so high? How are people making a living doing this? Well, it kind of acts like as a crucible, like it's just this pressure cooker of so many musicians in one place and there's no support and no money. Nobody goes out to see live music, but so many people go here because it was such a musical mecca and there's so many great musicians playing all the time. So you have all these people going with this insane hunger and drive and desire to play music around this incredibly rich and rewarding environment. And when you have those people really struggling to survive and like perfect their craft while doing it, then the overall level of musicianship just kind of skyrockets. That hunger might not always exist in other places, that like overarching, consuming, workaholic approach to music. It can be kind of destructive, like living in this environment because of how like necessary it is to dedicate yourself to the music, but it's worth it for a lot of people in the end, myself included, because of the quality of musicianship that lies here. It's a question of balancing whether or not you want to have that sort of experience as a musician. At some point, maybe I won't want to do that. But for right now, I really enjoy being in this environment and seeing all that is around me.
Stanislav Kogan writes, "Hi, Adam. A question maybe for a Q&A, or who knows, maybe a video. It's about beats and analyzing waveforms. Imagine Reaper with vertical lines for beats. The real sound almost never starts with the highest amplitude. When you pluck a string or play a chord, there's always a little preceding tail at the beginning of the sound, which reaches its maximum a bit later. So the question is, what would be the visual, quote, playing in time criteria? When the sound begins exactly on a beat line, or when it only becomes the most loud, the intended note, on this beat? Thank you in advance."
It's a tricky thing, because locking something to the grid visually doesn't always mean something is going to feel like it's locked in, because sometimes transients of some instruments might kind of clash with other instruments, and it might sit better in the mix if, like, for example, a kick drum transient occurs right before the bass guitar comes in. I've always felt that it's a little bit better, at least in the mix, to have the bass guitar occurring slightly after the kick drum versus right on top of it, for a variety of reasons. It just sort of mixes better, it feels better, and it sounds like it's tighter if that's the case, versus if they're trying to compete with the exact same sonic space right on top of one another. Now, we're talking about distances of milliseconds, very, very subtle distinctions between when attacks occur and when they don't. And, you know, at the end of the day, like anything music related, it just comes down to using your ear and not relying solely upon what you're seeing on the screen in front of you to govern musical choices.
John Chen writes, "Hey Adam, question for your next Q&A. I noticed that you seem to address and push back at certain comments that espouse a sense of musical elitism. As someone who considers himself open-minded, I very much appreciate this. As someone with a BA in music, however, I can't help but lament how much songs on the radio blend together for me because of how cookie-cutter they seem. And why are there some artists who are so talented and innovative, Jacob Collier, Esperanza Spalding, Gallant, to name a few, who have no mainstream exposure / appreciation? Do you have to, / how do you, reconcile these parts of yourself in order to keep playing popular music that non-musicians want to hear? You mentioned in your last Q&A that seeing the craft that goes into it firsthand helped you appreciate pop music. I'd love it if you could elaborate on that a bit."
So there's like this trend of people making videos which are supposed to be like these exposés on how easy it is to create pop music. Like, you just auto-tune your vocals and comp them and then just write like banal lyrics and then like come up with some crappy beat and you have your club banger and oh my god. And in the comment section, there's all these people saying like, oh, this is so easy, anybody can do it. I always have to laugh. The amount of time and energy that went into them is obvious to me. You can't approach anything with any degree of cynicism towards the craft that you are doing and expect it to come out well. The thing that I always say to people who say, it's so easy, anybody could do it, then why aren't you doing it? What is stopping you from doing it? Like, capitalism, for all of its flaws, does kind of work. Like, if you're trying to create a good pop song, you are competing with people who are really good at creating good pop songs and, you know, actually are approaching it with some degree of like truth, inner truth to it. Like, they're really feel strongly that this is the craft and this is the music that they want to make. And, you know, you have all the tools. You do have autotune. You do have a laptop. You do have access to crazy samples. And, you know, probably you have access to some good singers too. Why aren't you pumping out the hits? Well, it's because you don't actually have any drive or desire to do pop music. And the people that do are the ones that are succeeding because they aren't approaching it with this sort of disdain that most people do. And that's fine. You don't need to like pop music at all, but that's kind of where I'm coming from with this. You know, I don't really like the Chainsmokers. I don't get anything artistically or spiritually or anything from their music. It does feel like, to me personally, like this is like disposable to me. But at the same time, I can appreciate what they're, you know, what they did in order to get the sounds that they got and just like the production value that goes into writing a Chainsmokers song. Like, you have a bunch of people getting together to write songs and work on pop music that are very earnestly trying to do this. And when you have that quality of person just who has dedicated their life to that and getting a bunch of them together, you're going to get a quality product, hopefully. It's kind of the same way of like thinking about like all the people that are necessary to create a Michael Bay movie. Like, there's a lot of stuff that goes into that. There's a lot of people spending a lot of time on the Transformers movies. So you can appreciate the craft of them. Maybe they aren't so much like an artistic experience, but you can at least understand, hey, that CG team spent a lot of time getting that Transformer to look really, really cool. So just appreciate it for that aspect of it. And you're appreciating it because the CG team earnestly is believing in it. It's not just some kid in their basement messing around with After Effects thinking, oh, it's so easy to make a Michael Bay movie, because that doesn't really exist. And you know, when you're talking about like art versus non-art and pop versus artistic music. You know, it's something that's not new. It's been happening forever. Salieri was more popular than Mozart in his day. Both were fairly popular, but Salieri was more popular. Bach wasn't very well known in his day as a great musician. He was actually known as a pretty decent organist, but not as the greatest composer in Western counterpoint history. History has a tendency of like changing perception of people appreciating things differently after their time. Jimi Hendrix wasn't super popular in his day. Don't worry about that. If notoriety is your most important goal as a artist, I think maybe change your perception, because you're not going to grow as an artist and you're not going to grow as a human being if that is your main mode of creating, like feeding into the sense of like, I need to be known very well. Of course, it helps monetarily. Of course, it helps your ego, but those aren't always going to be the best things for developing the best art for yourself.
Christian Hasselberger writes, "Hey Adam, love your videos. Congrats on the follows. I had a question for you. What effects slash pedals do you like to use for bass? Similarly, how do you set them up so the bass still accomplishes its job, subfrequencies, thump, etc., while being colored slash affected? Cheers."
So I say this in a fair number of my videos, but I'm going to say it again. The most important effect for any bass guitarist in this contemporary musical landscape is the octave pedal, and being able to dial in some cool sub-octave sounds, or at least different sounds that make your bass guitar kind of beefier in certain situations, or just as like this tonal color that just changes the sound of your bass. It definitely changes the feel of how your bass fits within an ensemble. If you get a sub-octave pedal happening, the really low end really just changes the feel of everything. You know, bass guitar kind of hits a little bit higher than the kick drum normally, just in terms of where it is on the frequency spectrum, but when you have a sub pedal, it hits with the kick drum, so you have to take that into consideration. Now, with a lot of different effects, it's actually kind of hard, at least within a mix, to pick out the sound of the effect, because most of the time when you're playing within a mix, your bass is kind of sitting below everything else, and the affected sound is kind of hitting the higher frequencies of your bass guitar sound. Like if I was to ever play with a chorus pedal, or I don't know, like if I was playing with a phaser pedal, most of the time it would just get lost in the mix unless it was a very open sort of sound, a very like light mix, a light sound, versus when I was playing like just a regular bass guitar part. That's one thing that I have to always take into consideration whenever I'm working with any sort of overdrive pedal, because overdrive is a very fickle thing for a bass guitar, and a lot of companies have made bass specific overdrives because the low content kind of gets either sucked out or placed in a rather odd location in the frequency band that kind of makes it difficult to play bass guitar like you would normally play bass guitar.
Frisky Maulida writes, "If you knew about the myth of Sisyphus before your senior recital, why did you still get depressed afterwards?"
There's a big difference between intellectually understanding something and then living through it and then feeling it, and then truly making that experience a part of yourself. I mean, the best way I can sort of explain it to the musicians is like, hey, yeah, it might take a few minutes to learn the C major scale, but it takes a lifetime of application to really get it underneath your fingers and really make it a part of yourself and make it a part of you. You can't just learn a scale and then play it up and down and say you know it. You have to really make it a part of your music making. And knowing all the ins and outs of that scale takes a many, many years and takes actually experiencing and living through the scale. Maybe I'm taking this analogy a little bit too far, but that's kind of the whole thing. Me having heard about the myth of Sisyphus before my senior recital didn't really prepare me for living through all that experience, and then the whole continual creation and destruction of the artistic process. That's just something that I've had to like learn about by myself. So that video, in a way, maybe it will help you, maybe it won't. Maybe it will help you through the process. If you haven't experienced it before, though, it may maybe give you some ideas, but you know, you just kind of have to do it for yourself.
Anyway, guys, thank you so much for tuning in to Question and Answer Time with Adam Neely. If you're listening to this as a podcast on iTunes, be sure to remember to rate and review. Please comment, like, and subscribe. And also consider joining my Patreon, because it's the patrons over at my Patreon that make this channel possible. So thank you so much, and until next time,
peace!